Well, can you hear me? I guess. Okay. Well, it's really good to be here. We got to have dinner with some of you last night, and it was just a really enjoyable evening for my family, and we got to go back to Jerry and Janine's house, and just really great. So we're really happy to be here. What we'll do is we'll have class for a little bit, and then hopefully I'm going to try to watch the time. So 10:15 is about when class gets out, is that right? And so what I'll try to do is get done a little bit early so that we can talk, and if you have questions for me, you can ask questions, and I'll answer them best I can, and that way we can just get to know each other a little bit more before worship starts. But let's start this morning with a prayer. God, we are thankful for mornings like today, where we get together with our brothers and sisters and study your word. And we know that as we gather, that you are among us and that you will work even in the midst of our imperfections and mistakes and our misunderstandings of your word to bring about truth in our life. That the same spirit that guided the writers of scripture guide us as we read it and enlighten us to your truth, God. And so we're thankful for that. And we pray this morning that we have open hearts to your word, that we can receive what you want to say to us this morning, and that we can not just know it in our minds, but we can internalize it in our hearts and make it a part of who we are and the way that we live. And we're thankful that you will do that. And we know that you are faithful in that. We're thankful for Jesus. God, we want to live like him. And that's hard for us. We still have a long way to go to get there. And so we need your help for that as well. And we pray for that. We're thankful for his death and his resurrection that give us hope. We pray that we live and in that hope, and that we share that hope with others. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm a youth minister, and one of the blessings of being a youth minister, I've been a youth minister at the same church for 9 years, and so the kids that are in my youth group right now, they have not known a youth ministry without me as their youth minister, and so I get to know them pretty well, and they're pretty honest with me. And one of the things I love about teenagers is that once you get to that point, they're not going to really hide anything. And I'm thinking about when I come into class, I know, like, by the postures in which they're sitting, how receptive they are going to be to the lesson for that day. And so there's just good postures to receive. Right, to be, this is my wife, by the way, right there, Lauren, for those of you that, and then, but there are just good postures to receive. There are good postures to do the different things that we do. Probably sleeping would be, and we would say laying down is the best posture in which you should go to sleep. If you're driving, the best posture should be sitting up, right? And it's the same with God. There are postures in our life, maybe not physical postures, but character and heart postures that make us more receptive to God. And we're going to look at two passages this morning, two stories in Scripture that talk about the right posture that we should have to receive from God. We're going to be in Job. And we're going to be in John chapter 9. We're going to move through Job like super quick, so you might not even turn there. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to John 9 and just kind of just stay there for a few minutes. We'll get to John 9 and read a little bit more of it. But when I was in middle school, I played basketball, but I was the shortest kid on the team. And not only was I the shortest kid on the team, I was the shortest kid in our class. And we had a pretty big class, a couple hundred kids in our class. I was the shortest boy or girl. But I was pretty quick, and I could dribble well, and so I made the basketball team. Our basketball team was horrible. It was awful. And there were five other middle schools in our city, and so we had kind of a couple of tournaments, but we had 10 big games, two against each school. And there were four schools that before the game started, we had lost. There was zero chance our team was going to beat four of the schools. But there was one school that we actually had a shot against. And we lost to them the first time, but the next to last game of the year, we were playing them, and we felt like we had a good shot. For one reason, because they weren't very good like us. But two, they had several players that had failed, and so there were only five players that could play on this court. So they had to play the entire time. And this is going to get much worse, because about in the third quarter, a few minutes into the third quarter, I mean, it's just after halftime, one of their players fouls out. So they are now down to four players, and they've been playing all game long, and we have 10 players, we can play five at a time, so it's 5-on-4, and we're winning at this point. But they start to come back and kind of gain on our lead. And I remember this one I'll tell you the end first. We lost the game. Four players that had played the entire game came back and beat us at our last shot to win a game. We did not win a game all season. But I remember this one moment in the game where I was guarding their smallest guy, right? And if you know basketball, you know like what a pick is, where somebody else from the other team comes and blocks you so that they can go around you, right? Well, this guy comes and he picks me, and he is the biggest guy on their team. And our guy yells, "Switch," which means as the guy that I'm guarding runs over this way, the guy that was guarding this big guy goes with him, and I stay on the big guy. Well, I mean, this big guy just kind of makes his way down to the basket. They throw him the ball. And I mean, like, he turns around. If you could have just taken, like, a picture and shown it up here, any basketball person, anybody that knows basketball at all or just understands the game at all would look at the picture and say, there's something not right here. Something went wrong this is not the way it's supposed to look. Because he just turned around, of course, and I had no shot. I didn't even try. Like, he just turns around and puts the basket in. But you stop and take that picture. Here's the smallest guy on the team guarding the biggest guy right under the basket. It just doesn't look right. It's not the way it's supposed to be. I feel like that's the way the story of Job starts. Because if you'll remember the story of Job, what happens is that God is up in heaven, and some of his angels are coming to talk to him. Some of his council of angels is coming to talk with him. And you remember who comes with them? Satan. And I just think if we could stop and just take a snapshot of that and look at it, this discussion in heaven between God and his angels, and Satan just is there and seems like comfortable there. Like, he's supposed to be there having this conversation with God. It's weird. It doesn't seem like it's the way that it's supposed to be. And so you probably, if you know this story, you know that they start to have this conversation, and Satan is saying, you know, I've been around your world. There's lots of sin going on down there. It's pretty awful, right? And God says, yeah, but have you seen Job? Have you seen my servant Job? He is great. He is righteous. You will find no fault in Job. And Satan gives him this kind of challenge. He says, yeah, but, you know, the only reason he's righteous, the only reason that he's holy, the only reason he's faithful to you is because look what you've given him. Why wouldn't he be faithful to you? You have blessed him so much. He is so rich. He has got a nice family. He's got land. He's got possessions. He's married. He's got everything that someone wants for life. Why would he be unfaithful to you? You've blessed him so much. And he says, I think if you took that stuff away, he wouldn't be faithful. Now this, here, I think in this moment, as much as God can be vulnerable, Satan has made God vulnerable here. Because this is the challenge, not just for Job, it's for all of us. I think what Satan is saying to God is, your people, they'll be faithful to you as long as you are rewarding them. It's not just Job's challenge. This is our challenge as well. It's easier sometimes to be faithful when things are going really well in our life. And so Satan throws that challenge to God. God says, okay, let's do this. Let's play this game. And like, that seems weird to me too. That just doesn't seem right either. It seems like they're playing with Job's life. And it's going to get to the most intimate areas of his life, the most important and valuable areas of his life. And it seems like it's kind of this game between God and Satan. It's weird, right? Because Satan says, if I start to take some of this stuff away, he's going to walk away from you. And so he does. He starts to take away stuff. He takes away his possessions. He takes away his land, his wealth. He takes away all of his children. And yet Job remains faithful. And so God and Satan have another talk. And God says, look, I told you. I told you. He's doing great. He's still remaining faithful. And Satan comes back to him and says, yeah, but You didn't let me touch him. You didn't let me do anything to him. He's just got all this stuff outside of him, but he's still fine. She says, okay, don't kill him. Like, can you imagine that? Like God selling Satan. All right, you're going to get to go and you're going to get to go and mess with Terry's life. Just, you can do anything. Just don't kill him. I don't want that. I don't want that. I don't want to be part of this challenge. But this is what Job gets. So God says, just don't kill him and do anything else. And so he plagues Job with this horrible disease. And he's got sores all over his body. And then a discussion starts because Job now has had it. And for like 35 chapters in Job, he goes back and forth with his friends. And I want you to see that his friends come and they stay with him. And they come and they try to minister to him. But they come with a very specific message to Job. A message that says, basically, we know why you're suffering, and we know what you need to do about it. And I'm going to read, I could pick any number of passages, but I'm going to read three passages. These are things that Job's friends said to Job in the midst of his suffering. They said this: consider now who, being innocent, has ever perished. Where were the upright ever destroyed? As I have observed, those who plow evil and those who sow trouble reap it. And the breath of God, at the breath of God, they are destroyed. At the blast of his anger, they perish. So they start off with Job saying, look, the way the world works is if you're righteous, you're blessed. And if you're being punished, if there is suffering in your life, it's because you've done something wrong and you're being punished. Okay? Here's another one in chapter 5, verse 1 through 7. Call if you will, but who will answer you? To which of the holy ones will you turn? Resentment kills a fool, and envy slaps the simple. I myself have seen a fool taking root, and suddenly his house was cursed. His children are far from safety, crushed in court without a defender. He just says, like, I know what's happening here. You're a fool. That's why you're being punished. In 5:17, he says this. He says, his friend says, blessed is the man whom God corrects. So do not despise the discipline of the Almighty. Like, he says, this is what's happening to you. You're being corrected. Something was wrong in your life, and now you're being corrected. But maybe the most harsh thing that was said, he says this: when your children sinned against him, he gave them over to the penalty of their sin. Now imagine that. Your children have just died. Just died. I mean, he is still grieving. And Job's friends say, yeah, your children were sinful, and they got what they deserved. I mean, and this is in chapter 8. It's only going to get worse. I mean, it gets really heated between Job's friends and him. And their basic message, I want you to hear this, their basic message is you have sinned, and this is punishment for your sin. And if you will just repent, then all of your suffering will go away. Now, this is the dominant theology of the day. That if you are being blessed in your life, it is a reward for something good that you've done. And if you're suffering, if you're experiencing any suffering in your life, it is a punishment for something that you've done. It's punishment for sin. And this was probably Job's theology before he himself experienced suffering. But when he experiences the suffering, he says, no longer can I have that theology anymore. My experience has caused me to change the way I view God and to view the world. And so he goes on this course of like trying to wrestle with what is going on here. Because what he knows, what he thought he knew before, was God is a just God that will reward the righteous and punish the evil. But now what he knows is, I don't deserve this. This punishment is not in line with my life. It doesn't correlate. So I've got to find a new way to understand God. And so he starts to say some things. He starts to call God out a little bit. He says some really bold things to God. He says this: what is a man that you make so much of him, that you give him so much attention, that you examine him every morning and test him every moment? Will you never look away from me and let me alone even for an instant? He says that to God. He basically says, leave me alone. Just for a little bit, leave me alone, God. He's bold. All right, in chapter 9, he says this: He says, how then can I dispute with him, with God? How can I find words to argue with him? Though I were innocent, I could not answer him. I could only plead with my judge for mercy. He says in chapter 13, he says this in verse 20 through 24. Only grant me two things, God, and then I will not hide from you. Withdraw your hand from me and stop frightening me with your terrors. Then summon me and I will answer, or let me speak and you reply. How many wrongs and sins have I committed? Show me my offense and my sin. He goes on in the book to call God to court. Imagine that. This just doesn't look right. This is not the way that we imagine a relationship with God to work, where you say, you know what, God, let's go to court. I think I can beat you. I think I know my life well enough that we go to court and you can be the judge and you're also going to be the prosecutor, but I think you as the judge will acquit me. That's what Job says. You'll let me off because I'm right. And so now he's wrestling with, okay, there's suffering. I'm experiencing suffering. What is it? Why? Why am I doing it? And so at the end of the book, as Job keeps summoning God, come down, come down, let's talk about this. God does come down. And if you remember how he responds in a way that a parent responds when their kid thinks to themselves, just give it a rest. Just stop. Like, I hear you're repeating yourself. If you're a child, you probably, a teenager, you've probably said that to your parents before, or at least felt that you're repeating yourself. I understand. I get it. Job had to have felt that way, because when God comes down, he starts to just ask Job question after question after question of, hey, what do you know about the world? Do you know where rain comes from? Do you know how the animals work, how the circle of life works? Like, are you there when I pour hailstones out of heaven? Like, do you know the way the world works? He really challenges him there. But then at the end of the book, he doesn't give any answers. He doesn't really answer Job. He doesn't. He just basically says, you don't have this figured out. You don't thinking clearly. And you probably can't think clearly about the way suffering works in the world. But then he comes at the end and he says something really unique. Job's been calling him out for like 30 chapters. And he says at the end of the book, hey, I'm mad at your friends, Job, because they didn't speak well of me like you have. He says, Job's friends, they didn't speak well of me, but you did, Job. You did. And so you need to pray for your friends so that I'll give them forgiveness. He says, you spoke well of me. Okay, we're going to come back to that. But now let's turn to John 9. John 9 is one of my favorite stories in Scripture. It's the story of Jesus healing a blind man. And it's going to start, and you're going to very much, right off the bat, you're going to see the connection with Job. Because here's what it says in verse 1. As Jesus went along, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? So you see right off the bat, this is the theology of Job's friends. Here's a man on the street. He's a beggar. He is blind. He must have done something. Him or his parents, one. I mean, he was born blind, so he was either born blind because of sin he was going to commit in his life, or he was born blind because of something that his parents had done. So they lay the question right out there. They come with Job's friend's theology and say, all right, who's to blame for this? Somebody's got to be to blame, and here's what Jesus responds with. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. Now, I have a rather unorthodox view of suffering, and I want to share it with you. Because I don't think what Jesus is saying here is, hey, God chose this man, and he blinded him at birth for this moment, 30 years later or whatever. I really don't think that's what Jesus is saying. I may be wrong, and I'll humbly say that. I may be wrong, but I don't think that's what Jesus is saying here. I think what Jesus is saying here is the world that we live in allows suffering to move in it. We all experience suffering. And while no one is to blame, no person necessarily is to blame for every bit of suffering. Sure, there's some suffering that is caused by sin, but not every bit of suffering can be blamed on one person. And And it might not even be because of any reason at all. It could be completely random. Have you ever felt like there's some suffering in your life or in a loved one's life that just seems to not make sense any at all? That just seems to be completely random, like unnecessary, unexplained suffering. I think that a lot of suffering is this way. It's just random. But every suffering, I think what Jesus is saying here is that there is suffering in the world. God created a world in which suffering could exist because there is always an opportunity there to grow in our relationship with Him. There's always this chance for God to move in and to act in a really big way in the midst of our suffering that increases our faith in Him, increases our trust in Him. And so as when we go back to Job's story, what we see is like Satan keeps saying, hey, he's faithful to you because you've rewarded him and you've blessed him. But I think what Jesus would say is, yeah, I mean, yes, but also if you've grown up in the church, if you've never known what it feels like to be lost, it can be a tough battle to get to the point where you can receive grace because you've never... I grew up in the church, and sometimes it's hard for me to receive grace because I've never felt lost. And I've got a kid that's grown up in the youth group, or that started to come to our youth group. In fact, her first Sunday was the first Sunday we were there. And she used to lament all the time, you know, I don't know the Bible stories. I don't know the most basic Bible stories at all. I'm so envious of y'all. And like, we're like, no, we're envious of you because you know what it's like to be lost. And like, there's great joy in the grace that you've received because you know what it's like to be lost. It's the same with suffering. Like, suffering is here in the world, and it is this moment, these moments in our life when we really need God to show up. There's no other option that we have. We just need God to show up, and when He does, there's great blessing there. And so I think what Jesus is saying is the world exists in this way so that God's glory can be revealed even in the midst of suffering. And so he says this, but this happens so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. And then he has this really, really weird moment where he spits on the ground and makes mud with dirt, and he rubs it in this guy's eye. I think it's okay to say at this moment that Jesus is being a little bit gross. And I don't really understand what he's doing. But whenever I'm teaching teenagers, I try to look for the physical elements in the story and see if we can't like bring those into class and have those be a part of the class. And so one Sunday, I had a kid come up and sit in a chair, and I had some dirt. And I also had a cup of water, and I had his friend come up, and I was like, hey, we're going to make mud, and you're going to rub it on your friend's eyes. Okay? And he was like, no. Like, let's do spit, because that's what the story says. And I'm like, we're not rubbing spit mud on your friend's eyes. And the friend was like, yeah, let's do it. You know, so with both of them saying yes, I was like, fine, let's do this. So this one kid, he kind of dumps out the dirt on this plate and he starts to spit. And it took a lot of spit. Like, this is not like one little spit that Jesus spit out and then he's able to make. It's not miraculous spit, I don't think. He's fully human, right? Fully human, fully God. It's not this special spit. So, I mean, this kid in class, he had to spit over and over and get water to resalivate his mouth. And he keeps spitting and he rubs it together and he rubs it on. It's gross. And Jesus does this. And I have to put myself in the shoes of the blind guy who can't see. He doesn't know. Like, it doesn't say, maybe Jesus told him, hey, I'm not spitting on you, I'm spitting in the dirt. But maybe not, though, and he doesn't really know. Like, Jesus just spitting over and over again. He's got to wonder where this spit's going. And then Jesus rubs it in his eyes and tells him to go and wash. And after that, he can see. And the point, and then that's not even really, that's just the intro to this story. It's not really the point of the story, because after that, I want to say this first, and we'll come back to this. After Jesus tells him to go wash, Jesus is nowhere to be found in kind of the main part of this story. He leaves, and he is not around anymore. He's going to make a re-entrance into this man's life. For a little while, he kind of leaves him out to dry because the Pharisees hear about this, and they're not happy about it. They don't like this. And so we'll jump down to verse 8. It says, his neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that he was. Others said, no, he only looks like him. But he himself insisted, I am that man. So they asked, how were your eyes opened? And he replied, this man called Jesus made some mud and put it in my eyes. He told me to go wash. And so I went and washed. And then I could see. And they said, where is this guy? I don't know. He's nowhere to be found at this point. He's nowhere to be found. So they brought the guy to the Pharisees, this man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was the Sabbath, and therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he received his sight. Guy says, he put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and now I see. And some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, well, how can a sinner do such miraculous things? And so they were divided. They go to this man's parents, and they say, hey, is this your son? Was he born blind? They're like, look, yes, he is our son. Yes, he was born blind. We have no idea how this happened, because what they're afraid of is the Pharisees are going to kick him out of the temple. And being kicked out of the temple is not being just kicked out of church. It is being kicked out of your social life. So it's being kicked out of school and church at the same time. It's being kicked out of your little league and your church at the same time. It's being kicked off Facebook and your church at the same time. You are being ostracized from your community. And so the parents are like, I'm having none of this. I don't know. We're going to let our son handle this. And so we don't know. We're not going to be implicated in this. So they go back to this man a second time in verse 24, and they summoned him, and they said, hey, give glory to God. We know, now this is really important, I want you to hear this sentence. We know this man is a sinner. That's what they say. We know this man is a sinner. And then look at the next verse. I love it. I love verse 25 because this is his reply. Whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. But one thing I do know is I was blind, but now I see. Like, look at the discrepancies in the way the Pharisees, the religious leaders. I mean, these are the guys that are supposed to have it figured out. These are the guys that are supposed to help people connect with God, connect with the Messiah. And here's what they say. We know he is a sinner. And then you have this blind guy. He doesn't know much at all. He doesn't know whether this guy's a sinner. All he knows is the experience that he had with Jesus. And so I don't know whether this man's a sinner or not, but I know I was blind and now I see. And I imagine there's some people here, some people that go to church here that maybe are new to faith. Maybe you don't have a lot figured out. Maybe you don't know much about who God is or about doctrine or about what Scripture says. But maybe you're here because you have had some experience with Jesus. And Jesus has done something in your life. And I want you to know that that is powerful. And that it is powerful to say, I don't have everything figured out. I don't know all about God. And I don't know all about Scripture, but I do know this. I used to be in addiction, but now I'm free from that. My marriage used to be on the rocks. It used to be broken. And now, because of Jesus, things are healthy again. And sometimes the most powerful thing that we can do is to stop trying to just explain God and justify God and just to say, look, this is what Jesus has done in my life. And everyone can do that. Everyone that's had an encounter with Jesus can do that. We may not have all the right words to say. We may not know how to lead someone to Jesus. We may not think we know how to lead someone to Jesus. But it's powerful just to say, this is what Jesus has done in my life. Well, they kick him out of the synagogue. They kick this man out. His parents weren't willing to go through it, but he goes on to challenge them a little bit. He kind of mocks them a little bit at one point. He says, what, do you want to be this man's disciples too? And they curse him, and they kick him out of the synagogue. And once he's kicked out of the synagogue, Jesus shows back up in his life. And so Jesus, it says in verse 35, Jesus heard that they had thrown him out. And when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Who is he, sir? The man asked. Tell me so that I may believe in him. And Jesus says, you've now seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking with you. And then the man said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus says, for judgment I've come into the world so that the blind will see and that those who see will become blind. So some Pharisees are close by, and they ask him, "Are we blind too?" Jesus says, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains." All right, so how did these two stories connect? You see in Job's life, in Job's story, you have Job's friends who come to Job and they say, we've got it. We understand suffering. We know what God's doing here. We know why you're suffering, and we know what you need to do about it. And Job says, I don't have any idea what God's doing. And he's super honest with God, even to the point where we're maybe even a little bit uncomfortable with some of the things that he's saying to God. But guess what? God's not uncomfortable at all. He's absolutely comfortable with Job calling him to court and saying, leave me alone. Right? At the end of it, he says, Job spoke well of me. And so we get this story of one group of guys saying, we've got it figured out. We know. And another guy saying, I don't understand, God. I just want you to show up and talk to me and just be here with me. And then in John chapter 9, you have these religious leaders who are saying the same thing. We know who Jesus is. We know this guy. He's a sinner. And you have another guy saying, I don't know who he is. But I know I had a good experience with him. I know he did something in my life. And Jesus says, so God, you know, God the Father, he says, hey, Job's friends, they spoke wrongly of me. And Job in his honesty, in his questioning, he spoke well. And then Jesus comes in and says, hey, those guys that think they know it, that think they can see, they're blind. And because you know that you're blind, you see. So there's this posture that God is trying to teach us, that Jesus is trying to teach us, that says, we got to have some humility. We can never get to the point where we think we've got this figured out. And God would much rather spend his time with people who call him out, who ask him, what are you doing? Who complain to him, who raise their voices in anger and rage to him, in honest anger and frustration, than he would with people that just say, we know the formula. We know the way this is supposed to work. And I don't think it's any coincidence that you see Jesus meet the beggar on the outside of the city, right? Jesus is with the beggar outside the city. And then when he's taken into the Pharisees, Jesus in the religious center is nowhere to be found because they're closed off to him. They're closed-minded. So he's nowhere to be found in the religious institution, and it's not until he's thrown out again outside where Jesus comes to find him. If the church can't be the place where we can come and be the have humility and take this humble posture before God, God's going to go find it elsewhere. He's going to go find it outside with the people that don't know the answers, that are just willing to be honest with God. But we want that to happen here. We want that to be the church. We want the church to be a place where people can come and raise honest questions and humbly say, I might be wrong about this. I don't have things figured out. But I'm drawn to Jesus because he keeps doing good things in my life. And that's a lot. That's a blessing. That's a blessing for the world if the church can be that. Right? Okay, let me pray, and then we have a few minutes. It's 10:15, it's when class is over, right? So we have about 10 minutes. I'm doing some questions. Let me pray for us, and then we'll have some question and answer time. God, a lot of us grew up in the church. God, a lot of us grew up learning about you, and we are thankful for that. There's great blessing in knowing your stories and in knowing your word, and so we are so thankful for that. But God, we pray that we can never let our knowledge of Scripture, our knowledge about you, take away from us humility as we approach you and honesty as we approach you. So God, we pray that you give us a humble posture, that we know that we've never arrived, that we've never figured you out, that we're never going to figure you out, that we always have something more to learn. So we pray for a humble posture. And God, I also pray that our eyes can be open to the ways that Jesus is working in our life. that while we may not have everything figured out, we can experience Jesus in our life. And I pray that you give us boldness, like that blind man had, to share Jesus' experience, or the experience we have with Jesus, to others. Because we know that will go a long way to bringing hope and life to a world, to a community that really needs Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so if there's any questions about my family or about me that you want to ask, or anything, really, feel free to ask. We have a five-year-old and a three-year-old. Will is our five-year-old. We have a little girl named Reese, who's three. So,
I have a question.
Yes?
You said in your paper here that you were married 11 years. Why'd you get married when you're
14? So, I have been married 11 years. So, when I first started at the church where I'm at right now, I was 25. And we got married when we were 22, right out of college. And but my first Sunday, a grandmother of one of the teenagers came up to the teenager and was like, "Hey, tell me, introduce me to your friend here." And he was like, "This is our new youth minister." So she was like, "Oh, okay." So I, all the time when I was starting in youth ministry, was mistaken for a teenager. And in fact, like, we would show up at like a trip that we were going on. We showed up at a climbing trip. And we're at the gate, or at the desk. All of us were standing around the desk, and the lady was like, she could tell, she was just looking over, and she was like, "Who's in charge here?" She could not tell. So, we got married at 22, though. What else?
Where did you grow up?
Grew up in Abilene, so not far away. In fact, my wife grew up in Abilene, too. Our parents still live there. We have siblings that live there as well, so not too far. We understand that Wiley is we didn't go to Wiley. So don't lump us in with Wiley.
Did you go to school at ICU?
I did. I have an undergraduate degree in history and then a master's degree in ministry. Anybody else? She grew up until eighth grade. She kind of moved all around. She was in Ennis for a little while, in Kerrville and Vernon, Texas. And then she moved to Abilene when she was in eighth grade. We were in the same youth group together. And we weren't really friends in high school, oddly. And so we didn't start really becoming friends until college.
What influenced you to want to go into youth ministry and into ministry?
Okay.
Is this something you want?
No.
Or what occurred?
Not at all. I was wanting to be a public school history teacher or possibly a professor in history. And when I graduated from college, my wife had, she's a CPA, and she had one semester of her master's work left. And so we were kind of in, you know, just kind of me. I was in a little limbo of 7 months where she was going to be in school, and so I didn't really know what I was going to do during that time. And a minister from the church at Southern Hills Church came to me and said, "Hey, why don't you work with me while she's finishing up school for a little bit? I want to do some projects. I want you to help with some stuff." And just felt like God was doing something there and was calling me into ministry. And so at the end of that first summer, decided to go back to school.
Who was the minister?
Donnie Carroll. Yeah. Anybody else?
Could you share just a little bit about how you feel God is calling you from youth ministry into the pulpit?
Sure. So I've been a youth minister for 9 years, and in 2014, our preacher went on a three-month sabbatical during the summer, and the elders asked me and another guy to kind of fill up the summer. And so so I was able to preach a good bit in the summer and teach an adult Bible class that summer, and it was just really energizing to me. And so that kind of started the process of thinking, like, okay, you know, at some point I'm going to have to think about what's next. Was still felt like God wanted me in youth ministry, but at least at that moment I was feeling a little bit of a pull towards more adult ministry and preaching. And then just in the last 6 months or so, I've also felt a push. Just with my family, with my kids getting a little bit older, and their activities kind of filling up. Youth ministry takes a lot. It takes a lot of outside of work hours. And so just felt like it was a good time to... And our oldest is starting kindergarten at school. So it's just a really good time in my life right now. Feeling a push from youth ministry, but also a pull, and then just circumstantial as well. Just God's kind of lined it all up really well. All right, anybody else? Well, if we haven't met you yet, we'd love to meet you. And so I think we have a few minutes before church starts. And so if you haven't met you, we'd love to come up and meet us and ask us any questions you didn't ask already.